All right, in this video, I want to get into what is known as the 7-year tribulation, and I want to get into this to show that I don't see this 7-year tribulation in the Bible. I've been looking for it and studying it, and I don't see it. I don't find it. So I'm going to get into the only place where there's a mention of a 7-year period. And it's in Daniel chapter 9 where we get the 70 weeks prophecy that tells us when the Messiah, Jesus Christ, was to show up and do what he was going to do. So, if we go into Daniel chapter 9 and we start here at verse 24, the angel Gabriel is talking to Daniel and he says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the most holy. So this is the context, right? This first sentence is the context to this whole paragraph. It is about the holy city to finish transgression, make an end of sins, reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, seal up the vision and prophecy, to anoint the most holy. That's the focus, right? So we read on and it says, know therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the Prince, shall be 7 weeks. And 62 weeks, the street shall be built again, and the wall, even in troublous times. Right? So, what we see here is 70 weeks are mentioned, but here a total of only 69 weeks are mentioned. Right? But all these 70 weeks are determined for this, right? Upon the holy city to finish transgression. And yada 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 here, right? Well, we got 7 weeks and 62 weeks, so a score is 20, so 64 is 60 in 2 weeks, plus the 7, 69 weeks, right? So there's 1 week missing off of here, right? Through the study, you can find that there's a decree at 538 around these times. This is not exactly sure this is the exact time. But around 538 BC, there was a decree put out to rebuild Jerusalem. And then in 457 BC, there was a decree to put out to reinstate temple services. And then in about 445 BC, there was a decree to actually finish and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And you can see here that it says the command to go forth to rebuild Jerusalem unto the Messiah, right? Shall be 7 weeks, 62 weeks. The streets and the wall will be built, and even in troublous times, right? So this includes the wall. So that's why a lot of people start at about 445 BC, where the final decree is out to rebuild the wall and to actually rebuild Jerusalem and the temple and the wall. Takes up this first 7 weeks, which is 49 years, because you get a day for a year. And 7 times 7, 49. So 49 years to start to rebuild the whole city. And then we got 62 weeks left. This is a total of 483 years. And after this time of the 70 weeks, everything's rebuilt. Then you get the 62 weeks left. And it says right here that the street shall be built again, the wall, even in troublous times. So it's after it's built, then it says, and after 62 weeks. So we can take this to mean that this period is broken off. The 7 weeks is because this is the time it takes to rebuild. And after it's rebuilt, then 62 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off, right? But not for himself, And the people of the prince shall come and destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood, and unto the end of the war desolations are determined. So here we see that after the 72 weeks shall the Messiah be cut off, right? It says the Messiah will be cut off. That doesn't say that this last week is cut off. It says the Messiah shall be cut off. And we know he was cut off because he was murdered. Right? And then it says after he's cut off, then the prince shall come, destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with the flood, on to the war of desolations are determined. Right? So it's talking about the city being rebuilt. And then a prince is going to come and destroy the city and the sanctuary. Right? It's not talking about a new Jerusalem and a new temple from our point of view that's going to be built, that's going to be destroyed. It's talking about Jerusalem that was already rebuilt after Babylon took over. That already happened. It was already rebuilt. The new temple was built and it was already destroyed. And we're going to get into that after we finish this paragraph up here. It goes on to say, and he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week. And in the midst of the covenant, in the midst of the week, he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease. And for the overspreading of abominations, he shall make it desolate, even until the consummation. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. Right? So a lot of people take this to mean that he is talking to the prince about this prince here that's going to come to destroy, right? You could take it that way, but the context is about the Most Holy being anointed and he's ending iniquity, right? And this is upon the city, the holy city, right? And this covenant, right, is the new covenant, the New Testament. You know, in Jeremiah, I think it's chapter 34, talking about the new covenant being written on our hearts. The Messiah was cut off in the midst of this week. He started his ministry at the age of 30. Sorry about that. He started his ministry at the age of 30. And 3.5 years later, he is cut off. Right? And since he is cut off, he was the actual sacrifice that all the sacrifices were pointing to. They were all supposed to get you to think about the Messiah, about Jesus. And that's what happens here. He comes to confirm the covenant, just like Moses confirmed a covenant between God and Israel. Well, there's a new covenant being confirmed. And in the midst of the week of confirming the covenant, he puts an end to sacrifices because he is the sacrifice. And there was the veil between the Most Holy and the holy place, and that veil was ripped in half. It was done. No more sacrifices are needed. Those were just to point to Jesus. Now that Jesus has been the sacrifice, it's all done. So when everyone's talking about this 7-year tribulation, like, what makes you think this is all of a sudden cut off and it's separated to another period of time? I don't see why they do that, because we got 70 weeks, right? And we have 7 weeks. As soon as the decree is put out, everything's rebuilt. And then right afterwards, it's not cut off. We have 72 weeks. The Messiah shows up. Right? And in the midst of that, it when Jesus shows up after 62 weeks, he does his ministry. After 3.5 years, he is cut off. And he puts an end to the sacrifices. So there's actually a 3.5 period of time, which you can say was not fulfilled. Not sure. That's something to really get more into. Maybe that is something that's actually cut off. And the actual tribulation period is 3.5 years to deal with the Jews. And I'll get into why that makes a bit more sense than this. What do we got here? 7 years, right? Because he's saying the Messiah shows up and he's cut off, right? He shows up to confirm the covenant for many for 1 week. So he's saying he's supposed to be there for 7 years to confirm the covenant. But in the midst of it, he's cut off and he puts an end to the sacrifices and oblations of the cease for the overspreading of abominations. You shall make it desolate even until the consummation. And that determined shall be poured upon the desolate. And when Jesus came, the fig tree represents Israel. There wasn't fruit. He cursed the fig tree to produce no more fruit. It withered away as soon as he said it. He told the religious leaders, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, that he's taking the kingdom of God from them and giving it to a kingdom that's going to produce the fruit thereof. He did all these things, showing that he's moving on and basically divorcing Israel. And then this prince comes and destroys the city, which we see here. Whoops. That's something I'm going to get into in a second. 70 AD, Rome sieges Jerusalem, besieges it, and at that time, the Christians left when they saw Rome surround Jerusalem. And I don't know, I guess the Jews thought God was going to save them or something. But it didn't happen. The Romans ended up holding out for about 5 months, 6 months or so. And the Jews started to starve to the point where they would eat their own children. And then finally the Romans charged in and wiped them out, destroyed the city and destroyed the temple. Not one stone was left upon another. They completely wrecked it. And that was the prince that was to come. We see here, after the Messiah is cut off, but not for himself, and the people of the prince that shall come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary. That has already happened. So when they're talking about, oh, this is a future event. No, this is something that happened right after this prophecy of 70 weeks. There's no reason to think it's cut off. The only thing that would make any sense of being cut off is 3.5 years, because Jesus was cut off halfway through the week. And when he raised, I don't know how long he was on the earth before he ascended. But I don't think it was 3.5 years. So I don't think he finished it. I think it makes sense that there is a rapture right before this 3.5 year period where God's going to confirm the covenant, new covenant with all the believers, with the whole bride, the whole church. And during that 3.5 year period where the believers are in heaven and enjoying the marriage supper, that is when this tribulation of 3.5 years is going on. So, we'll go over here. I'm going to show why that makes actually a bit of sense. Because I was getting into this and I was like, this sounds like exactly that. In Matthew chapter 24, keep in mind, Jesus is talking to Israel. So he's talking to Jews here, right? That's something to keep in mind. And One of the things I want to point out here is Jesus says, the first thing he says when they ask him about, you know, the future, he says, take heed that no man deceive you. That no man deceive you. And he says, for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. Now that right there is very informative. Because a lot of people think there's going to be a lot of people saying that they are the Messiah, which there have been. Matter of fact, the Pope says that he's the Christ. So all the popes were saying they were Christ, and they've been deceiving many. But not only that, but it's saying that there's going to be people who are coming that say Jesus is the Christ, because these commas aren't there in the original language. So he can be saying, many are going to come in my name, saying that I, Jesus, am the Christ, and thou shalt deceive many, which people do. They come saying that Jesus is the Christ, but they bring in a bunch of lies and deception. So you can take this in both those ways, but you all have to get close to God yourself and not trust in a church, in a pope, a cardinal, a bishop, a pastor, a priest, what have you, evangelical, or whatever. You can't put all your faith into someone like that, into a man. You got to go to God. Yes, you can listen to someone like me, to somebody else, but you cannot hold them as your standard. Like, if you disagree with them, you can't go, oh, well, I have to put my conscience on the back burner there, and I have to agree with this man because he's the standard for truth. No, no man's the standard for truth. If you don't agree with me because of yada, 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 you have to follow your conscience. Right? I'm not the standard for truth. Even though you might agree with everything I've said ever up until this point, I am not the standard for truth. You need to follow your conscience. You need to follow God. Right? But anyway, continuing in Matthew chapter 24, Jesus talks about the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel, right? And he tells them to flee when they see this. And that's exactly what the Christians did when the Romans came and encircled Jerusalem. All the Christians left. And the interesting thing is when the Romans surrounded Jerusalem, the emperor died. And they were at a standstill for what they were supposed to do because they had to get a new emperor and all this. So the Romans just were around Jerusalem for about 5 months, allowing all the Christians to actually get out. And then after that, they sieged for another 5 or 6 months before they actually came in and destroyed the city and the temple. So those things already happened, right? And we go on here, and Jesus, I'm not sure if I wanted to start at this fig tree or here. He talks about, you know, if they say Jesus is here, there, and wherever, don't believe him, because Jesus is coming in the sky, and when he returns, he's going to be raising up the saints, and then he's going to raise up those who are still alive that are also the saints. And if that's not happening, then it's not Jesus. But anyway. It says here, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. So you see here exactly what I was saying is like that he's coming in the sky. So if they're saying he's there, here, wherever, it's bullshit. You know, not to believe it. But he gives a warning here. How are you supposed to know when this time is coming, right? Because this did not happen after Rome sacked and destroyed Jerusalem. right? And if we go to the top here, the disciples were asking him about the destruction of the temple, right? And here we go. That's what I was looking for. And the end of the world. So he was telling them two different things here. He tells them about the destruction of the temple, right? And then he goes into the end of the world. And he says, you know, when I'm gone, and they're saying I'm here, there, and wherever, don't believe them. And then he tells them of a sign. He already cursed the fig tree, if you read Matthew, already up to this point. So this would all make sense if you were reading Matthew from chapter 1 all the way through. He cursed the fig tree, right? The fig tree represents Israel. But then he says here to these Jews, now learn a parable of the fig tree. When his branches is yet tender and putteth forth leaves, ye know that summer is nigh. So likewise ye, when ye shall see all these sayings, know that it is near, even at the doors. Verily I say unto you, this generation shall not pass till all these things be fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. And obviously, the people passed away that were alive during Jesus' time, because this is about the end of the world. It's saying when you see the fig tree puts forth its branches, that the generation that sees that is not going to pass away until everything's fulfilled, right? We've seen Israel come back as a nation. 1948, right? This has happened. So, yeah, that was a sign, right? And he goes on here. He says, you see, this is the first sign. You see Israel starting to put forth leaves and whatnot. It comes back. He goes on to say, excuse me, but of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And they knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken and the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken and the other left. So he seems to be talking to the Jews about what's going to happen with the Gentiles, because Noah was a Gentile, he was not a Jew. Right? And he's saying it's going to be the same way as before the flood. Now, before the flood, you didn't have Jews, right? And people were marrying, drinking, having a good time, doing their thing, you know, living for this world, for this life, and building up a legacy here in this world, right? Not to mention there's other weird things that you can get into that were going on before the flood. But anyway, he's saying things are going on as normal, right? After Israel has come into existence, things are going to go on seeming as normal. But all of a sudden, one is taken, one's left. One's taken, one's left. So he's telling them, okay, you see Israel pops into existence. Now, all of a sudden, people are taken, they're gone, right? So he's telling these Jews, you're going to see all of a sudden these Gentiles disappear. Not all of them, obviously. So he's telling them, watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in which, what watch the thief would come, he would have watched, and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh. Who then is a faithful and wise servant servant, that was weird, whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season. Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. But, and if that evil servant shall say in his heart, my Lord delayeth his coming, and shall begin to smite his fellow servant, and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looketh not for him, and in an hour that he is not aware of, and shall cut him asunder, and appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. All right? So, from the context, what I see going on here is there's not a tribulation going on when there's a rapture. Things are going on as normal. You know, people are eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage and, you know, until the day Noah entered the ark. So people were taken. They were protected from what's to come. So the Jews, this is a warning for them. Israel starts as a nation. Then all of a sudden, the Gentiles are taken up into the ark. Then you know the flood is about to come. Because they didn't know until the flood came and took them away, right? And the same thing shall happen when the Son of Man comes. Right? So he's saying watch. So why would you need to watch if you're going to be taken, right? Because it's not just about Gentiles, watch so that you're ready to be taken as the bride, but that these Jews who have rejected Jesus, they see Israel form. They see all of a sudden the Christians, Gentiles, taken. Then the flood comes. Right? That's another thing that it says here about the prince shall come and destroy the city and the sanctuary, and the end thereof shall be with a flood. Right? A flood is like a great multitude of people. Waters represents that. So, that's what it seems to be from this context. They ask him about the destruction of the temple and end of the world. So he tells them about the destruction of the temple. And he's saying, after this destruction, you know, people are going to be saying, I'm here, I'm there, da 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 da. Don't believe it. So you take this chronological order. This is what's actually happened. This destruction has already happened to the point where parents were eating their children. It was a great tribulation. Right? And then he's talking about when he's going to return. And he says, okay, you want to know when I'm going to return? Watch for Israel to bring forth branches. Right? And then you're going to see a rapture. Then we might have a 3.5 year period. I can't say that for sure, but that's the only period I can see that's actually cut off from here that doesn't really give us an end. Because what we actually see is about 70 weeks and 3.5 days. Is what we see here. So there's still 3.5 days that aren't actually talked about here. And that could be the period after a rapture. So I'm going to go to this right here. Right? And even this actually shows what I'm saying, which I think is interesting. Right? They just put here for, like I said, the times are a little different, right? It says 457 is the date to actually rebuild the wall. That's what they're going to use here, right? And then there's 49 years of everything's being built. Then after 62 weeks, Jesus shows up. Then 3.5 years later, you know, after he's an adult, He's cut off in the midst of confirming the new covenant. Covenant. Right? And see, they even put here, begins his ministry 27 AD, 31 AD, crucifixion. These dates I am not necessarily agreeing with. I'm just using this as an example. So that's 3.5 year period, which they don't seem to add to the 7 year period at the end. They just take it, they cut it, the whole thing off, and put it here. When 3.5 years has already been confirmed, the other 3.5 I haven't seen confirmed in the Bible. So that could be something that is at the end, because the fig tree comes back. So the time of the Gentiles comes to an end, which is something that is actually talked about in the Bible. So the time of the Gentiles can be over. God calls his people out of there, raptured them. Then he goes back to dealing with Israel, and they got their problems to deal with for about 3.5 years. Because after that first 3.5 years that happened right here, the sacrifices and everything's already been cut off. Everything's done. There is no temple. But the fig tree is now producing leaves again. So at any time, this last 3.5 year period can start. That's what it seems to be being shown in the Bible when I prayerfully look and study. And then I prayerfully ask for guidance while I do these videos. And these are the things that make sense. I don't agree with this right here. I'm using this just as a little template to show you what I actually believe and how I see it. And this is just a visual, a nice visual to back up what is being said in Daniel. But you can see here at the end of the 62 weeks, this 3.5 year period, because it says right here, this is 27 AD, and they have 31 AD, the crucifixion. So this 3.5 year period, they just ignore it. They don't acknowledge this. They all of a sudden, they cut off from right here, and they jump to the end of the world and put it here. I don't know why they do that. It doesn't make any sense to me. When obviously there's a 3.5 year stretch before the Messiah is cut off. And if we go to Daniel, what does this 70 week have to do with? It has to do with the holy city to finish transgression and to make an end of sins and make a reconciliation of iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness to seal up the vision and the prophecy and to anoint the most holy, right? So that would include this 3.5 year period until Jesus is crucified, because that's when all those things are actually accomplished. In the midst of confirming the covenant, new covenant, for 7 years, he's cut off. Then a period later, Rome destroys Jerusalem and the temple. And it's the time of the Gentiles until something. The rapture happens here, and then there's 3.5 years of a tribulation where God's dealing with Israel again, trying to get fruit from them. And that's when I think Satan has full control over the Gentiles, because all his people are taken, and they're going to be deceived and gathered up. And that's a whole nother study to get into what's going to be happening then. But I just wanted to get into that because it just didn't make any sense to me why they keep throwing a 7 year period at the end, to the end of the world. I don't see it. Maybe making this video, somebody's going to talk to me about it and show me there my ways, but until then, this is how I see it. So thanks for watching and take care.